by Professor Dr. A.L. Silver. Professor Dr. A.L. Silver is a professor at Institute of Biomedical Sciences, University of Sao Paulo. We are very grateful for Professor Dr. A.L. For his time and for accepting our invitation. The title of his talk today is The Role of Amino Acids in the Bioenergetics of Trypanosoma cruzi. And the purpose of this lecture series is to promote global and scientific cooperation and build research capacity to find new and better therapeutic solutions for the neglected tropical diseases, which remain a huge health burden in the member states of the Organization of Islamic Cooperation. We are also very grateful to our participants who are joining us from various parts of the world. And with this, I request Professor Dr. Iqbal Chaudhry, Coordinator General Comstec and Director ICCBS, to introduce and welcome our guest speaker today. Over to you, sir.
Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are in different time zones. As always, this is a global lecture series where we have participants from four different continents, from South America to Asia, and far Eastern Asia, in fact. This lecture series, I'm extremely grateful to our colleague in Durham University, Professor Dr. Paul Denny and Max, for agreeing to conduct this lecture series, and for the effort of Dr. Samar Yusuf and Fazima Mazam for taking it through. But I think the most important component of it is to have wonderful speakers. And we've been absolutely fortunate to have some of the most most prominent speakers in the field of parasitology, in the field of molecular medicine, in the field of drug discovery and development. And today's speaker is someone who is very close to my heart. I met him first time in Durham several years ago, and I was always hoping that I would be able to see him more often, but pandemic has affected our meeting, and since then we are actually meeting only through online. I hope and pray that Ariel would be able to come and visit us in Pakistan. Comstec is an organization which represents 57 member states of the OSCE, which is Organization of Islamic Cooperation. And these countries are located in four continents of the world. So you would be pleased to know that two countries in South America, Suriname and Guyana, are the members of OIC. And then most of West Africa, Central Africa, and East Africa, Middle East and North African region, Central Asia, and South Asia are the member, the 57 member states. And unfortunately, many of these states are least developed. They are in tropical countries. They're affected from whole range of different problems, including illiteracy, lack of medical supplies, a lack of healthcare research, and of course, triple burden of diseases. That is the reason why we found it extremely important to have this program, structure program, in which NTD and Comstec work together to introduce and develop capacity of scientists in this region. And they should be able to benefit from top speakers of the world. We intend to continue this lecture series into actually workshops on various skill sets related to tropical diseases, drug identification, lead identification, and drug target identification. And I'm sure that different skill sets in the form of workshop would benefit a lot of younger people, and also to help us to take this legacy of this wonderful project beyond its lifespan, and would be able to have new linkages develop between the scientists. I'm absolutely pleased to introduce my dear friend, Professor Dr. Ariel M. Silver. He's from the laboratory of Trypanosoma, and he is among the leading experts in parasitology. He works for the Department of Parasitology, Institute of Biomedical Sciences, University of Sao Paulo. He's from Argentina, as we know, but he has been working in Brazil since long. He graduated from the biological science and got his PhD from the Faculty of Exact and Natural Sciences of University of Buenos Aires. After that, he migrated to Brazil, where he obtained his postdoctoral position funded by Sao Paulo Science Foundation, and then started working at the Department of Biochemistry, Institute of Chemistry, University of Sao Paulo. After that, he obtained his first grant as an independent early career researcher funded by FAPESP. In 2006, he was hired as an assistant professor by the Department of Parasitology at the Institute of Biomedical Sciences, University of Sao Paulo. And since then, he's working as a very high caliber, very productive scientist at that department. He has a fairly intense engagement with the subject, as he is a very frequent traveler in different South American countries as well as in Europe. He has been promoted to the highest cadre of academic leadership, and he is now is among the top scientists in the field of trypanosoma, tropical diseases, and his emphasis has been largely on the biochemistry of parasites. He is also a member of the board of directors of Brazilian Society of Protozoology. His research has been focused on various aspects of parasitology. And the topics of his interest has been on metabolism and metabolites, transport, bioenergetics, mitochondrial physiology of parasites, as well as the development and validation of new drug targets to design new anti-parasitic drug, which is very, very important because these are neglected tropical diseases and very little funding and international attention is unfortunately available to identify new targets and thus to identify new drugs. ALE is certainly one of the most cherished person working in the field of Chagas disease, and he has deciphered the complex life cycle of trypanosoma at the molecular level, and today he's going to talk about some of his fascinating research. I have had the honor of meeting him and listening to him, and I'm sure that you would all benefit. There are a lot of people online, and I'm sure that you would be able to benefit from this wonderful presentation of today. Thank you very much, and I invite Ariel for his presentation.
Thank you very much for this very kind introduction, Iqbal, and I would like, before starting, I would like to say thank you to you, Samer, and Comstec for this opportunity of showing our research here. Okay, I can share my screen now. Yep. So, okay. So, is it okay? Are you seeing the screen?
Yes, we can see your screen.
Perfect. Perfect. So we are in conditions to start. You can see the mouse just to use as a pointer. I'm not finding the.
Yeah, we can see the mouse also. Yeah.
Oh, here. Okay, I can use this laser tool. Okay, perfect. So I will try. I try to fit a good quantity of data that we have been obtaining in the last times about the metabolism of Trypanosoma cruzi, and we focused pretty much on the metabolism of amino acids. And I think you will understand soon in the presentation why. So a bit about this seminar, I will make a brief introduction about Trypanosoma cruzi, its lifestyle and metabolism, and then I will go to the very basic fundamentals of mitochondria and how we can think the mitochondria as a battery, okay? So we can talk about the bioenergetics using some very basic electric concepts. Then I will go to three amino acids, which are among the main metabolized amino acids by Trypanosoma cruzi. And finally, I will try to show you how we can obtain some numbers about the mitochondria yield in terms of bioenergetics. Okay, so I will start by the first point. So initially I will introduce you to Trypanosoma cruzi. Trypanosoma cruzi is the causative agent of Chagas disease. It has a complex life cycle which happens between an invertebrate host, which is popularly known in English as kissing bug, and a vertebrate host. Humans, of course, are here, okay? So in the, I will not go into the details, but in both hosts, the parasite alternates between replicative non-infective forms. For example, in the insect vector, it is the epimastigote, okay? That in some conditions differentiate into infective non-replicative forms like the metacyclic trypomastigotes. Once inside the mammalian host, we have also this kind of transitions. In fact, Trypanosoma cruzi is strictly intracellular. It needs to invade the mammalian host cells in order to differentiate into the first replicative form, which is called a mastigote because the, it doesn't have evident flagellum. The mastigote differentiates into an intermediate form, which is also replicative and non-infective, which is the intracellular epimastigote. It is called like this because it has some similarities with this epimastigote occurring in the insect vector. And in some conditions, these intracellular epimastigotes differentiates into trypomastigotes, which burst from the cell by lysing the host cell and are released into the extracellular medium. Once there, these parasites can reach the bloodstream, and if this vertebrate is bitten by a kissing bug, but it is making its blood meal in that moment, it can take up these trypomastigote forms, and they will differentiate in the midgut into epimastigotes, which will colonize and infect a new insect vector, which will be able to transmit it again to other vertebrate hosts. One thing that it is important to keep in mind is that this the entire infection of the kissing bug happens in the midgut. Okay, it doesn't reach other territories of the body of the insect. So the epimastigotes colonize the midgut of the insect in the anteroposterior direction. And in the terminal portion, these forms, the infective forms are formed. So they are expelled together with the feces and urine each time the insect makes it its blood meal. Okay, so this is important in terms of this seminar because for being all the time in the digestive tube of the insect, these forms are submitted to many severe stresses. I would like to focus on the nutritional stress because we will talk about bioenergetics. So this is one of the things that the parasite needs to cope with, okay? And the nutritional stress is particularly severe because of two issues. First, the parasite needs to compete with the very efficient epithelium cell for the nutrients. These cells are very efficient for taking up nutrients from the midgut one each time the parasite the insect feeds itself. But the other thing, which is most tough for the parasite, is the fact that this insect feeds itself in nature more or less once each 2 to 3 months, okay? So most of the time, the parasite is under kind of starvation conditions, okay? So this is the reason that we are trying to analyze how the parasite can take advantage of the small quantities of amino acids that it can meet in this environment in order to make them render energy, okay? So just a bit, the situation in the mammalian host cell is as well quite complicated for the parasite because it is hosted in the cytoplasm, not in an organelle. So the parasite in the host cell cytoplasm as well needs to compete for nutrients with the enzymatic system of the mammalian host cells that it is infected, okay? In this talk, I will focus mostly on epimastigotes because this is the form of the parasite that we have been studying more. And this is because we can obtain them in axenic cultures and we can obtain them in good, in high quantities. Once we understand as much as we go and understand better the metabolism of these forms, we can go for more precise questions to a more complicated system, which are the intracellular stages or the amastigote itself, okay? But in this talk, I will talk mostly about the amastigote, which is the replicative form, predominant replicative form in the intestine, in the digestive tube of the insect. Very well, so about the metabolism, I will not go in deep on the whole metabolism because we don't have the time for that, but just for introducing this talk, I would like to call your attention for this kind of curves. This kind of graphics has been published several times by many groups, but essentially what it shows is that if you follow the black line here, which is the represents the proliferation of the epimastigotes in culture medium, and you follow at the same time these black bars here, which represent the remaining glucose in the culture medium at a long time, you can see that as much as the parasite proliferates, it consumes glucose, but it doesn't consume it completely. At certain time, it stops consuming glucose and something happens that makes the parasite to release ammonium, which is represented in the gray bars. Meaning that there is a metabolic switch in some moment, we usually detect this at the mid exponential phase, in which the parasite stops consuming carbohydrates and it starts to consume amino acids. Okay, and this has been observed a good time ago. In fact, here this table is from a paper that has been published in the 76th last century, okay, some almost 50 years ago, in which these authors started the parasites and then stimulated them with some metabolites one by one, and they measured the oxygen consumption to see which metabolites are oxidated by the parasite. And they found that among them, the ones that are more oxidated are proline, aspartate and glutamate. There are others that we are adding in this list, but in that time, these were the ones that they tested. And this was very interesting because this pointed to proline in that time, aspartate and glutamate as well, as main carbon and energy sources for the parasite. One other thing that I would like to attract your attention on is the fact that the oxidation of metabolites in Trypanosoma cruzi, both carbohydrates or amino acids, are not complete. And the main products of this oxidation, of course, you can have CO2 as a product of the metabolism, but at the same time, there are other metabolites that are excreted, which are quite reduced. And this is a very a curious thing in a parasite that suffers of chronic metabolic stress, okay? So they excrete as well succinate, which is weird because it is a very variable metabolite in terms of energy, okay? And alanine, which is as well a very valuable metabolite in terms of energetic. Succinate because it is an intermediate of the TCA cycle, as you know, and alanine because alanine is nothing else than an aminated form of pyruvate. So, as you know, pyruvate is the main product of the glycolysis. So, one question that we are trying to answer now, and I will go to this on the end of this talk, is why a parasite that suffers of metabolic stress would be excreting a very valuable metabolite like pyruvate in the form of alanine. We, some time ago, we revisited this issue of the metabolic switch in Trypanosoma cruzi. We analyzed by a direct targeted metabolomics exponential and stationary phase parasites. And we, as you can see in this heat map, we clearly saw a change in the pattern of consumption of metabolites. This is the stationary phase, and these are metabolites related to amino acid consumptions, and this is the exponential phase, and these are metabolites related to the glycolysis. Okay, these have been represented in this kind of charts, in which, for example, have glucose and pyruvate as entry and exit of glycolysis, which are increased in the stationary phase with respect to the in the exponential phase with respect to the stationary. And the same happened with the intermediates of the TCA cycle that we were able to detect, with the only exception of alpha ketoglutarate, which has the opposite pattern. And this makes completely sense, because alpha ketoglutarate is the main entry door to the TCA cycle and to the oxidation system of metabolites such as proline, glutamate, histidine, and asparagine, for example. Okay? So here we have, for example, remarked the situation with histidine and proline, in which we have that, for example, the uptake of histidine and its presence, intracellular presence in the exponential, in the stationary phase, is increased with respect to the exponential. And something similar happens with proline, showing that, confirming in a way that they are being more taken up and metabolized. Okay? So I will now go very quickly to the very fundamentals of mitochondrial biology, just to make a quick reminder of some of the characteristics of the mitochondria. It has been called the powerhouse of the cell. We need to make a disclaimer here, because this is not considered anymore the only function of mitochondria. This was expression was said by Sikiewicz in the 50s, but now a lot of new information brought new functions for mitochondria, like, for example, being responsible for the cellular redox balance, cell signaling, the formation of the clusters of iron sulfur, which are the core of many essential proteins for all living organisms. And the mitochondria holds inside specific metabolic pathways in eukaryotes, like beta oxidation, polyamine biosynthesis, and so on. So mitochondria plays many roles beyond the being the powerhouse of the cell, but we will focus on this one right now, okay? In particular, in trypanosomes, this is valid for all trypanosomes, mitochondria have some unique characteristics, starting by the fact that these organisms have only one mitochondria per cell, and this is important for some calculations that I will show at the end, okay? It is a giant mitochondria that occupies between 10 and 30% of the total cell volume, depending on the species, on the stage, and so on. And it holds approximately 30% of the total DNA of the cell, okay? So how we can think the mitochondria as a battery, and this is something that I'm interested in to make some bioenergetics calculations afterwards. So as you probably know, all reduced metabolites during the catabolism, like sugars, amino acids, or fatty acids, are oxidated in a very controlled way through complex metabolic pathways. And this, during this oxidation, the electrons extracted from these metabolites are delivered into cofactors like fat to make FADH2, NAD to make NADH, and NADP to make NADPH. This can happen in many compartments of the cells, including mitochondria. But the only thing that happens in the mitochondria, of course, in mitochondriated organisms, is the fact that all these cofactors, in the presence of oxygen, produce electricity. And this electricity is the responsible for the driving force for producing ATP. Okay? And this is something that many often is forgotten by the people working on metabolism. And this is a characteristic that it is exclusive of the mitochondria, at least from what we know so far. And how this happens? Well, these cofactors are able to deliver electrons in a device, okay, that transport these electrons in a very organized way until oxygen to reduce oxygens. This device is called the electron transfer chain, okay, which is formed by four protein complexes, as you probably know. And during this process, protons are extruded to the extra mitochondrial space, and in fact, the intermembrane space, okay? And these protons, which are accumulated there, together with the electrical potential that it is developed between both sides of the membrane, are able to re-entry into the mitochondrial matrix through a very complex machine, which acts like a turbine of uses the proton entry force to energize the synthesis of ATP from ADP and phosphate, okay? Of course, this is a very, very simplified scheme. We have other entry doors that are due, for example, to uncoupling proteins, to channels, and to metabolites that are co-transported with protons. But at this moment, I will not refer to these processes. I will mention them later, okay? But what I would like to show you is that this closes an electric circuit in the same way or in a similar way than a battery, with the only exception that in a conventional battery, you have flow of electrons as charge, and the difference here is that the flow in the circuit is given by protons, okay? So once I say that, the question that we are trying to answer is, which are the metabolites and how these metabolites feed this battery to produce the reduced cofactors? And I will start by proline. So in this talk, I will only mention three of the amino acids. Of course, they are not the only ones, okay? I will start with proline. So to start with proline, we need to know how the proline catabolism happens. So we know that it can happen through two enzymatic steps to go until glutamate, and from glutamate to the components of the TCA cycle. It is very well known and very trivial, and we didn't dedicate to that because it is very well described in the literature. In fact, from glutamate, by deamination, we obtain alpha-ketoglutarate, and this is the entry into the Krebs cycle, the TCA cycle, okay? And this deamination can happen through glutamate dehydrogenases or transaminases. So from glutamate until the Krebs cycle, it is a very well solved problem that has been worked very well by many colleagues. So the thing that we needed to know in this point was how proline goes until glutamate. So we started by characterizing these two enzymes. Of course, we started by the first one, which is a proline dehydrogenase. We succeed in expressing the proline dehydrogenase in Escherichia coli as a recombinant enzyme, and as well, we succeed in using the gene of Trypanosoma cruzi to make a functional complementation of Saccharomyces cerevisiae. But from the enzyme expressed in Escherichia coli, we made a very detailed enzymological characterization, as you can see here. And one of the things that I would like to attract your attention to is the fact that this is a fat-dependent enzyme. This is not very unique because many proline dehydrogenases are fat-dependent, but this brought us the idea that, in fact, has been put in the literature as a possibility, but never was shown before, that maybe this FADH2 producing enzyme could be feeding electrons directly into the respiratory chain. And to make the story very short, we were able to prove this because of the characteristic of trypanosomatic enzymes, and this applies also for Leishmania, trypanosomatic mitochondria, which applies as well for Leishmania, which is the fact that being a so large mitochondria, this is very fragile, and you cannot isolate it without breaking it. Okay, and this is usually a problem to study mitochondria, the trypanosomatics mitochondria and so on, but we could take advantage of this. Because when you make this break of the mitochondria during the isolation process in a controlled way, you can have a lot of vesicles, mitochondrial vesicles that reseal. Some of them reseal inside in, some of them reseal inside out, but they reseal. In the process, they lost their matrix content, okay? And you can have these vesicles, which are empty, but they have in their membrane all the components of the respiratory chain. So you can stimulate this mitochondria with proline, and you can put proline dehydrogenase in the system and see if there is a transfer of electrons to a component of the respiratory chain. In this case, we choose to measure the reduction of cytochrome C. And as you can see, we succeed in showing by the first time, in fact, that proline dehydrogenase could deliver electrons directly to the respiratory chain without needing to go through the Krebs cycle pathway, okay? And we are sure of that because this part, at least part of this reduction of cytochrome C was abolished by antimicin A, which is an interrupter of the flux of electrons in the respiratory chain, okay? This graphic shows just a control of our mitochondrial vesicles preparation. This is a typical marker of matrix enzymes. This is citrate synthase, in which we cannot detect the activity. And this is fumarate reductase, a typical enzyme bound to the inner membrane of the mitochondria, which shows that we have the inner membrane with its enzymes on it, but we don't have the matricial enzymes, okay? So from this, we can conclude that the first step of proline oxidation pathway delivers electron into the respiratory chain. Then we went to the second step, and we made a very similar approach with an additional difficulty here. That was the fact that when we started to study this enzyme, we were not able to purchase the substrate of the second enzyme of the pathway, which is a pyrroline 5-carboxylate dehydrogenase, okay? This, of course, is a problem because you need the substrate to make an enzyme to work. So what we made was to make a collaboration with a chemist to initiate the in-house synthesis of this compound. It was quite tricky because this compound was not commercially available because it is very unstable. And we tried to make the second enzyme to work with this compound. In this moment, we could not succeed in making the enzyme work with this. So we spent a good time trying to think what could be happening. And to make the story short, what we discovered is that what makes the second enzyme to work is the product of the natural decomposition of this pyrrolic compound. And the natural decomposition was nothing else than the opening of this ring to make this semialdehyde, which is an analog of glutamate. So what, once we discovered that, we made a complete enzymological characterization and we succeed to make this. So, the first thing that I would like to highlight on this is that this means that this pathway is not just two enzymatic steps pathway, but an enzymatic step, a non-enzymatic step, and a new enzymatic step pathway, okay? And this was characterized with some detail by us. Here we made it's a NAD dependent enzyme that as well accepts NADP as a cofactor. And here we used a similar approach of that I mentioned for the proline dehydrogenase. In this case, we didn't measure the reduction of cytochrome C, but directly the production of ATP. But what we saw was exactly the same. This enzyme as well was able to deliver electrons directly into the respiratory chain, but through these cofactors, okay? So this allowed us to propose a very at the moment a very simplified model, which is represented in this chart, but that allow us to make some calculations that I will show you later. Prolin can be taken up. This has been characterized previously as well by us. Prolin can be taken up through two transporters, a high affinity and a low affinity transporter. Once in the cytoplasm, prolin is taken up by the mitochondria. This is a black box. We don't know yet how this happens, okay? But we know that it happens. We are trying to characterize this uptake right now. Prolin, once inside the mitochondria, is subjected to a first oxidation step, which produces FADH2 and P5C, which spontaneously decompose into the glutamate gamma semialdehyde, which is the substrate of the second enzyme, which produces glutamate with the concomitant production of NADH. Okay? And all these are delivered into the respiratory chain. So, now I would like to show you the second case, which is histidine. Histidine is a very interesting amino acid, and one thing that is attracting pretty much our attention is the fact that the histidine degradation pathway in trypanosomatids has been found complete only in Trypanosoma cruzi. It's not present in Leishmania, Trypanosoma brucei, or other trypanosomatids, and we are still trying to understand why. Okay, we don't have an answer for this yet. But this is a kind of interesting characteristic, and we are trying to understand how it works. So in an early work, we showed that histidine can be transported into the cell and can be oxidized to produce ATP. So the question that we were interested here to approach is how it happens. So the case of histidine is a bit more complex because the pathway, at least in its conventional view, is made, the pathway to glutamate is happens through four enzymatic steps, okay? Not too like the prolin situation. So we started to analyze these enzymes one by one. We found the genes encoding the first enzyme and the second enzyme. I will not go to the names just to avoid confusion. I will just name them as first, second, third, and fourth, okay, in the order that they appeared in the pathway. I think this is more clear for most of you. So we succeed quite easily in the characterization of the first enzyme, which is here, represented the activity in a kind of Michaelis-Menten curve, and the second enzyme as well. The problem came again when we tried to, the detail, the fourth enzyme in that time has been analyzed by another group in the USA. So the remaining enzyme to be studied was the third one. And this is being still very tricky, because again, we have a problem here with this substrate. This substrate is very unstable and nobody was able to report its synthesis so far, okay? So we tried to go again to our chemist collaborators, but they were not able to make so far a biosynthetic, a chemical synthesis strategy to obtain this in a stable way. So thinking the same way that we thought for the prolin metabolism, we said, okay, maybe anyway, if it is very unstable, how it goes from this enzyme to this enzyme, how it reaches it without decomposing? Or maybe these two enzymes are forming a complex and this happens, the transit between the active site of one to the second transit through an intramolecular channel that can protect it from degradation. But we never succeed in pulling down both enzymes together. So we still remain on the possibility of this compound being released by the second enzyme to the third one. And in the way, maybe it decomposes in something that it is the true substrate of this one, okay? So this was to applying more or less the same rationale that we applied for the prolin metabolism. So the problem was how to measure which is the decomposition production product of this, because it has been never obtained and has been never measured. So In this point, we asked for the help of our collaborators in Kinest, and one thing that came from their analysis and calculations was the fact that a possible product of the decomposition of this substrate here was nothing else than alpha-ketoglutarate, okay? So this brought a new light on the pathway to us, which was the possibility of having a pathway for full oxidation constituted only for the two first enzyme, and then from the product of the second enzyme, a direct production of alpha-ketoglutarate, which could be internalized in the mitochondria and directly be could be directly oxidized through the Krebs cycle. Okay, so one of the things that we thought is that if this is true, maybe the pathway was a two enzymatic step pathway, a non-enzymatic step. Okay, and from this alpha-ketoglutarate, maybe what people saw to define the pathway this way was nothing else than the reverse way from alpha-ketoglutarate to glutamate and from glutamate to formaminoglutamate. Okay, so maybe when the pathway was defined by the first time, they didn't think that the way could be this one in spite of being this one. Okay, I hope it is clear so far. Okay. So how we could show this possibility? We are still making several experiments, but I will show you the first one, which is a really consolidated result. And this is a conceptually very simple. What we made was to have a strain of Saccharomyces cerevisiae. In fact, Saccharomyces cerevisiae is a yeast that doesn't have this pathway. Okay, it naturally lacks this pathway. Okay, and what we made with this yeast was to transfect it in order to put inside the genes of Trypanosoma cruzi encoding for both enzymes, the first and the second one. Okay, both in the same cell. Okay, and once we had this yeast transfected this way, we stimulated this yeast with a uniformly labeled C14 histidine. I mean, this histidine has radiolabeled carbon in all these carbons, and we we incubated this yeast, and we put a CO2 trap in order to assess the possible release of radiolabeled CO2, which in fact happened. Okay, the system is very noisy. As you can see, this is the non-transfected yeast, and this is the yeast transfected with an empty plasmid, but this is the yeast which has been transfected with both enzymes. And as you can see, we have a good quantity of CO2 release coming from histidine, okay, in our system, which in principle show the supports the hypothesis of a two-step degradation pathway for histidine instead of four-step degradation pathway. Okay. So this allowed us to propose this chart, this metabolic pathway represented in this chart, in which the red arrows represent our proposal and the black arrows here represents the proposal that has been in the literature for the last 60 years, okay? So we propose that the true pathway, in fact, is this one. I mean, first step of degradation, second, which is deamination, second step. And from here, a non-enzymatic step to alpha-ketoglutarate or oxyglutarate, which are synonyms. And from here, inside the mitochondria and to the Krebs cycle to produce the oxidation with the concomitant production of the cofactors that fits the respiratory chain. Okay. And finally, I will go to alanine. In the case of alanine, I would like to mention that in terms of its pathway until pyruvate, as I mentioned, is very simple because it is only one enzymatic step which can be made by transaminases. I mean, alanine is produced by the transamination of pyruvate during the metabolism, as I mentioned earlier, okay? But this reaction is highly reversible, so alanine, in principle, could go back to pyruvate, and pyruvate could be converted into acetyl-CoA in the mitochondria and could be fully oxidized in the TCA site, okay? So, The question here is that we know, as I mentioned at the beginning of the talk, we know that alanine is excreted as an end product of the metabolism. And as I mentioned earlier, this is curious because it is a very valuable metabolite in terms of bioenergetics. So the question was, is it possible that alanine is accumulated extracellularly? Okay, and in a very emergential situation in terms of the bioenergetics of the parasites, could it be taken up again back into the cell and make the reverse pathway to be oxidized and to produce ATP? Is this possible? The answer is yes. So we measured the uptake of alanine through an active transporter that is coupled with the entry of protons. This requires a proton membrane potential having a component of proton gradients here. These protons are extruded by a proton at ATPase, okay? And we could measure the uptake of alanine in this way. So the next question is, has alanine a bioenergetic fate? And the answer is again yes. Here I will not go into the details, but what we could measure is that the starred parasites, this is very similar to the table that has been made in the 70s that I showed at the beginning. What we made was to start the parasites and then to submit them to the presence of alanine or histidine as a control or nothing. Okay, this is a kind of modified PBS. Mm-hmm. And what we see here is that the presence of alanine triggers the oxygen consumption and fits the respiratory chain. And we were interested in evaluating if this system was able to recover the ATP levels that fault because of the starvation. So here we had the starved parasites with this level of intracellular ATP, and here we stimulated with proline and histidine as controls, and we saw that when we stimulated the parasites with alanine, we had more or less the same level of recovery of ATP levels, showing that alanine could be really not only reuptaken from the extracellular medium, but could be used as well for ATP synthesis, for mitochondrial ATP synthesis. This was confirmed in this bar here, because when we treated the mitochondria, the parasites with antimycin A, the recovery of ATP was abolished, okay? So this allowed us to propose that alanine could enter inside. We know that it can be transaminated into pyruvate. This is from the literature. It can be transaminated into pyruvate in the cytosol, and pyruvate can be uptaken by the mitochondria. This was a paper of this year by the group of Roberto Do Campo. But we don't know, and we think that still alanine can enter directly into the mitochondria and be disseminated by transamination into pyruvate inside the mitochondria. This is something that we are currently investigating now. Okay. The thing, and this is one of the last things of this part, is that the trypanosoma cruzi has as well an alanine racemase, which means that it can convert L-alanine into D-alanine. And this was a very interesting surprise. So we were interested in analyzing this enzyme. We cloned it and we expressed it in bacteria. And to make it very short, we could measure its activity in both directions, from D-alanine to L and from L-alanine to D. And this is a very, this showed the kinetics, which is very typical from racemases, okay? And curiously, it is able as well to racemize, to racemize serine, okay? And this is something that we are currently investigating as well. But whatever, what we were interested in looking at is the fact that, okay, if alanine is excreted and there is a racemase here, okay, what is probably excreted is a mixture of L and D alanine. So the question that came here was if D alanine could be uptaken as well. And the answer is yes, it can be uptaken, okay, with a different kinetics than the L alanine. The uptake is less efficient, but it happens through, apparently it happens through the same system, because when we competed the uptake of D-alanine with L, we have an inhibition, and when we make the reciprocal inhibition, we got similar results, okay? So we propose now that both, in fact, are taken up through the same transporter and with the same mechanism involved, okay? These are the kinetics, the comparative kinetics, as you can see. Sorry, because the axes are in different scales, we should have them in the same scale. But as you can see, the maximum velocity here will go more or less to 0.5 nanomoles per 20 million cells per minute, and here it is in the order of 1.2. More or less, okay, 1.4, sorry, 1.2 here, okay. So the thing is that we have that D-alanine is transported, and as it can be uptaken again, we made the same measurements to see if alanine, D-alanine could be used also, could trigger also oxygen consumption, which we show here that yes, this is the modified PBS, and this is histidine as a control. As you can see, the level of oxygen consumption triggered by D-alanine is a bit lower than with L-alanine, which was similar to histidine, okay? But what it is important is that it is also able to trigger ATP synthesis at the mitochondrial level, which again is abolished by antimethylmethane, okay? So with this, we have a much more complex situation with the alanine use for bioenergetics, in which both L or D can be taken up. They can be interconverted in, inside the cytoplasm, and they can be transaminated in the, the L form can be transaminated in the cytosol and be transported as pyruvate, or it, we don't know still if it can be transported as L-alanine or maybe D-alanine into the mitochondria. This is something, like I said, that we are still investigating. Okay. And finally, this is the last part of my talk. I don't know how I am with the time. Just a minute to check. Okay, I think that I need to round up the talk more or less now. But I would like to go quite quickly to some calculations that we can make about mitochondria. Okay, which is, I think it is very interesting because it, I think that we need to start to make a more quantitative biochemistry to start to, for example, make predictions. So we have in the lab a very useful setup for making mitochondria, for making studies on mitochondrial physiology. The core of this is this equipment, which is a high resolution respirometer, a high resolution oscillographer. In this case, we have one made by Ouroboros, which is a company that it is set in Austria, okay? And this very weird equipment, in fact, it has two chambers here. One is covered here, the other is free, you can see it. And these chambers holds the parasites or the cells that you want to analyze, okay, inside. These are closed chambers. Hmm? And these blue things here and here are oxygen electrodes. This thing that it is connected here and the other that it is not connected here are devices for making real-time fluorometry on the same sample that you can measure the oxygen remaining at the chamber. And so from here, you can obtain several useful parameters, okay? So what we measure here essentially is the fluorescence and the oxygen remaining in the liquid that we, the culture medium, for example, that we put in the chamber. Mm-hmm. And from this, we can get this kind of records, okay, in which the blue, the violet line here is the remaining oxygen, the blue line here is the oxygen remaining in the chamber, which is when you put, for example, the cells in the presence of a metabolite, starts to diminish a long time, okay? And the, if you consider that this is a time course curve, the inclination, the slope of this curve, in fact, represents a velocity, which is the velocity of oxygen consumption. And you can set up the software in a way that it calculates point by point the slope of this curve, and you can have these kind of graphics, which you can then deconvolute to have precise numbers, okay? So for example, if you put in the chambers the cells and the metabolites, you have the cells respirating, consuming oxygen to oxidize this metabolite in particular. And in these conditions, you have what you can call the routine respiration. I mean, the cells standing alone with their metabolites and just staying, just breathing, okay? And then you can start to add, make subsequent additions, for example, of oligomycin in order to block the ATP synthesis, the mitochondrial ATP synthesis. And when you titrate the oligomycin and get the minimal oxygen consumption that happens in the presence of this metabolite, but without oxygen consumption, you have what is called the leak respiration. This is the respiration associated to the reentry of protons into the mitochondrial matrix through all the other paths that I mentioned before that can happen when you don't have ATP synthesis. Okay, so the difference between the routine respiration and the leak respiration, okay, is the quantity of oxygen consumed associated to ATP synthesis. And the leak respiration is the oxygen consumed not associated to the ATP synthesis, okay? And then you can uncouple the system with FCCP or any other proton uncoupler, okay? And what you have is the maximum capacity for this respiratory chain, okay? So this is a typical curve. And we can deconvolute these curves in order to obtain values for these parameters like are here. This, for example, has been obtained, and I will show mostly all this for proline because there is no time for showing for all the metabolites. But here, for example, you have the respiration parameters in MRC, which is the modified PBS, okay? In which you can see that we have some basal respiration activity, but not very much. And it is not very responsive to the treatment with oligomycin or the uncoupler, okay? But when we put proline, the resting state, the routine respiration is really significantly higher as expected. We have a value of leak respiration, which is not far away from the leak respiration in the absence of any metabolite, okay? And this distance from this to this is what is really associated to ATP synthesis, okay? And with this, we can make some kind of easy calculations. For example, making a very, very basic and simplistic model, we can say that for oxidizing one oxygen molecule, we need the flux of 4 electrons through the respiratory chain. Okay, so from the quantity of oxygen flowing, for example, for the respiratory chain associated to ATP synthesis, okay, we can derive it the quantity of electrons that has been committed to this process. And if you, and knowing this is from electricity, knowing that 1 ampere corresponds to the flux of 6.25 × 10⁸ electrons per second, we can calculate how many amperes we have in the system. So, for example, here we calculated for several metabolites. Here, for example, we have proline. We have that one mitochondria fed with proline can develop a current of almost 400 femtoamperes. Okay. And we can also measure the membrane potential, which we made following a method that has been described by Peter Michels in the 60s, more than 50 years ago, in which he proposed the use of safranin, which is a voltage-dependent probe. And making following his protocol, okay, and using a calibration curve, we arrived to a value of approximately 220 millivolts, negative inside, of course. This is the membrane potential in millivolts of the Trypanosoma cruzi mitochondrial inner membrane. Okay. And this was calculated for offering to the parasites proline at a concentration of 3 millimolars. Okay, so putting all this value together, we can, for example, calculate the power of this mitochondria in watts. Okay, so we are we know now that, for example, a single mitochondria of Trypanosoma cruzi fed with 3 millimolar proline can develop a power of approximately 80 femtowatts. Okay, so for people not having a clear idea of how much is it, let's say that if we could make the proper arrangement of mitochondria connected in serial and parallel to give the proper voltage and current, we would need in the order of 30,000 parasites to keep a red LED, a high efficiency red LED lighted. Okay. So as a conclusion, this battery in the case of Trypanosoma cruzi develops power of between 60 and 130 femtowatts per cell, depending on the metabolite and the conditions in which we measure this. And this is enough for synthesizing the ATP needed for the cellular functions of Trypanosoma cruzi epimastigotes. Okay. Well, we are expanding all these studies to all the amino acids. So we are analyzing all these metabolic pathways and now some others that are not schematized in this slide, but this is the core of our project on biochemistry and bioenergetics. And with this, I would like to finish my talk saying thank you very much for the people that was more committed and participated more of this project and these results. I would like to highlight the members of my group, which are described here, and Lisbane, who was the one that started this line of research as a PhD student many years ago, and Brian, who was fundamental as well in these studies, and who is currently a fellow of the our GCRF project based in Durham University. So, thank you very much. And now I am available for taking your questions. Sorry, this is the slide, the typical pandemic slides of our group so far. So thank you very much. And I am ready for taking your questions.
Thank you very much, Professor Dr. Ariel, for your expansive and very, very enlightening presentation and talk. With this, because we are running out of time, so I would only ask you two short questions, which have been posted for you in the chat box. Number one is the question from Mr. Jim. He's asking, are any of the amino acid metabolic enzymes encoded by mitochondrial DNA? I cannot hear you.
Sorry, sorry, I was muted. No, all the enzymes that we identified so far, all of them are encoded in the nuclear genome. Okay, in fact, most of the mitochondrial genome encodes some components of respiratory chain tRNAs, and it's a conventional mitochondrial genome in this point.
Right. So here is another question from Ms. Noor. She's asking, first of all, she's thanking you for a very nice presentation. And she's asking, is there any connection between amino acids being used by T. cruzi and the host environment?
Well, yes. In fact, I didn't mention, but relatively with some detail, for example, the consumption of protein by the parasites when they are as in the intracellular situation, when they are infecting the mammalian host cells. We know that, for example, proline is essential in this situation, but this proline is the proline provided by the host cell metabolism. So the parasite is able to take up this proline from the mammalian host cell cytoplasm and accumulate it inside and eventually oxidize it. So yes, this is very difficult to map because it is very difficult to split in a precise way the metabolism of the intracellular parasite from the metabolism of the cells. But we are working on it. And the answer is yes. Yes, they are very well related.
Okay, so here is the last question. Okay, let me see. So, Ms. Okay, there are many comments praising your presentation, I must say, and there are people who are wishing that you were teaching their students. And so here is a question. Yeah, there is one suggestion. I think you can comment on that. Can we talk about amino acid transporters later? So I guess there is a title for your next talk.
yes, I can see it's, I think it is Santusa.
My
friend and colleague Santusa. So of course, Santusa, I will be delighted.
Yeah, so here is the last question because we're running out of time. Can mitochondrial proteins of T. cruzi or other parasites be good targets for the biomarkers or drugs?
Can you repeat the question? I didn't get it.
This is from Mr. Hassan. He's saying, great talk. Can mitochondrial proteins of T. cruzi or other parasites be good targets for biomarkers or drugs?
Well, for drugs, we are betting a lot on that. I mean, and we are, in fact, collaborating with some people at the GCRF network. In fact, I saw that Tony Wilkinson, for example, is here, and we are trying to get the structure of this of some of these proteins in order to design drugs. We have some preliminary data showing that some of these enzymes are really essential and they would be a good drug targets. And as a biomarkers, I am not sure. We are not that much going in that direction, but it could be tried. And if somebody is interested in working with these proteins in that direction, we can help and collaborate, of course.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Ariel, for your time and talk today. With this, we come to the end of conclusion, and I still can see many remarks and questions in the chat box, but unfortunately, due to time, we cannot take them. We are also very grateful to our participants who joined us. And again, thank you very much, and we hope to see you and others as well in some other event of ComStack and Entity together. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thanks a lot.
Fazima, I just wanted to add that Professor Silva, there is lots of comments on your lecture, and we will share these chat with you.
Yes, this is something that I wanted to ask you. If you can send them to me, and I will try. I will try. Please, the people can also send the emails because I don't have the emails of some of the people, okay? And I will try to answer everyone, okay?
Okay, thank you, that's great. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
Goodbye.